Asked me to teach on finances this morning, and you know the finances as in the regards to the kingdom and to following Jesus and to tithes and offerings is over the years is something that my wife and I have really developed a passion for. Okay, we've really developed a passion for this in helping people find their place in the kingdom and really getting in line with what the Word of God says about the finances. And by the way, she says hi. She loves you all. She wanted to come this morning, but as we were talking, you know, you kind of got to leave a little early when you drive back and forth, and Annika gets up between 8 and 8:30, and it's going to be a late night for us because our MKF, we're going to have a ugly sweater dance-off party tonight.
Nice.
So we know Annika's going to be up late. She's going to be right in the mix of that. So we're like, it's better she sleeps. So she's with the girls, but she says hi.
Hi back.
So yeah. I'll tell her hi.
Yeah.
So, but this is a passion of ours, and the reason why is because we've actually seen the Lord move in miraculous ways as we have laid our finances at the feet of Jesus, given, and let the Lord just do His thing. And Tim and Janet have seen it. I will be honest, when it comes to the giving and then how the Lord provides, it doesn't make sense. They've seen it. So right now, what we just so you know is I do get some funds from Rock Laramie, but we also raise support to do our roles. And while I was full time at SROM, I was raising support. And I have to be honest with you, I haven't asked to raise support. I've been doing it now for about 9 years, and in the last 6 years, I don't think I've ever made an ask. And it's just amazing. As a matter of fact, a couple months ago, I was just up spending time with the Lord, and I was journaling, and I felt like the Lord told me, I'm going to start giving you family inheritances. And I'm like, what does that mean? Like, okay, Lord, you know, you put that on the back burner. I love you. You know, like, wow, that's interesting. And when I have it written in my journal, and then 2 weeks later, I got a letter in the mail with a card. And the card said, hey Josh, I was just thinking of you. My mother recently died and we inherited some money, and I wanted to share with you my family inheritance. Wow. Blessings to you and your family. And I was just like opening up my journal, like, whoa, what happened? You know, like, but the Lord just spoke. But my point is, man, the Lord has just proven Himself so faithful in our lives when things shouldn't make sense, when we've put it on the line and have tested this thing, and man, the Lord is like, He's provided every need we have, and then He just pours Himself on us as we give of ourselves and our finances in a very biblical way. And you know what? I really do believe we've experienced more intimacy with the Lord because we've chosen to go on the journey with Him and put our finances in it. You cannot follow Jesus wholeheartedly without the submission of your finances to Him as Lord and King. And you will not experience Jesus without the submission of your finances. So you can't follow Him, and you won't see a move in your life until this area becomes fully submitted. You go on the journey. And when you do, it'll blow your mind. It'll blow your mind. And so, wanna kind of lay a foundation here. How many remember the day, you know, when you kind of, man, you gave your life to the Lord? Raise your hand. It was that day of salvation. It was like, man, I became saved. Raise it high.
Mm-hmm.
Shout out some words that you remember that was just like, wow, man, this is amazing. You put your hand. Shout it out. What was that experience?
Freedom.
You were free. Okay.
Light.
Man, you experienced this free. What?
I experienced light.
Light. It was darkness to light. It's like, whoa, overwhelming light. I love that word because it's so amazing. What else?
Hope.
There was hope.
Hope.
Hope was gone. Now hope was restored. What else?
Thinking differently.
It's like, wow, holy cow, my mind is being renewed because of this love I've encountered. Automatically thinking differently. What else?
Relationship with the Lord. It went from religion to I have a relationship with it.
Relationship with the Lord. All of a sudden you have this loving Father who loves you, who's crazy about you, and who wants to be with you all the time. And it's just this love affair, love sick, amazing thing. Relationship with the Lord. Amazing. What else?
Peace.
Peace. There was peace that came. Awesome. Anyone else want to shout anything out that they experienced?
Surrender.
What?
Surrender.
Surrender. It was this place of surrender. That felt good, huh? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, I was like, you could kind of be like, I can breathe. You know, there's freedom in surrender.
Revelation, something is revealed that I hadn't known before.
Yeah.
Yeah. Revelation. It's like, boom. And yeah, it's amazing. We all remember it, that day, and then all those things that happened and deposited in you were carried through today. Okay? Now, so when you guys were called, when you gave your life to the Lord, something special happened. And we just kind of discussed some of the things that happened, right? When you give your life to Jesus Christ, okay, He calls you. He calls you to Himself. And when He brings you to Himself, you experience everything of who He is, love and light. And it just begins this amazing cycle of transformation. And when God calls you, He uses special thing. He not only calls you to Himself to be with Him for eternity, but you are now His special possession. When you gave your life to Jesus Christ, it's not just, hey, now I'm going to heaven. You literally surrendered your life over to Him, and He looks at you and calls you His special possession. You're His. This is what Paul is talking about in Galatians 2:20. I have been crucified with Christ. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. No, excuse me. Yeah,
yep.
I get it right? Mm-hmm. Sorry, I was like, uh-oh. Okay, so.
My life is not my own, I was bought with a price.
There it is. You were bought with a price. You're His special possession. He bought you. Now, when it comes to our own personal lives, we have to understand the call to salvation is a call to Himself and a call to be His special possession. All right? Prior to this, you were a slave to Satan. He rescued you out of the possession of the devil and brought you into the kingdom of light. So the Father came. He rescued that day and brought you into light. In other words, it's a better way of living and a better way of doing things. So you're His special possession, and He started showing you and revealing to you how to do life. Right?
Yes.
Now, what a lot of people forget about is not only your life was ransomed and became God's special possession, so all of who you are, but then everything you have also becomes His special possession. So all of who you are is God's special possession. You're His special possession. But now, everything you own, everything you have, is His special possession. This is salvation. You don't own your life. You've been bought with a price. You don't own your things. God bought them. Because He bought you. Alright? When you become a born-again believer, you and your things come under the rule and the reign of a king. This is super important, especially when we talk about finances. Because most people like the idea of having a loving father and serving, knowing Jesus as king and making Him Lord, but they don't realize, wow, the moment I do that, I am His, He is mine. Everything I have now is His, and they don't realize everything He has is mine. That's what it means to be His special possession. Okay? So, I want to share with you some, it's just basically three key principles when it comes to giving of our finances and walking this out. Okay? These are things Amy and I have discovered. Tim's coached us in these. We learned these through a book called Treasure Principles, but we've put these to the test. All right? And we're going to kind of go through three key principles in regards to finances. So is everybody understanding what I'm saying here?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? The call to salvation is a call to be God's special possession, right? But that in that, all of who you are and everything you have falls under that category. You don't own yourself. You don't own your things. He does. All right? So key point number one, when it comes to finances in the kingdom, You ready? So number one, God owns everything. Make sure I write it. I am his manager. Put on earth. All right, so let's open up a couple of verses here. Let's go to 1 Peter 2, all right? First Peter 2, 9. First Peter's after James, before 2 Peter. Alright. 1 Peter 2:9. Okay. So here's Peter. He's coaching the people of God on what it means to be a temple of the Lord God. Okay, to be a people that are of his presence. Alright, that host his presence. Okay? But this scripture, this is huge. He says, 1 Peter 2:9. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. All right, you are God's special possession. He owns you. He owns everything. All right? 1 Peter 2. So let's go to another one. All right? Let's go to Job 41. Job 41, 11. I'll just read it here. Look up at me once when you find it. I don't want to go too fast. All right? Okay, Job 41, 11. So here's Job. God is talking with Job, and here's something he says to Job. This is amazing. Job 41, 11. Who has first given to me that I should repay him? Whatever is under the whole heaven is mine. All right. God owns everything. All right, let's go one more. Psalms 24. Psalms 24, verse 1. Okay? Psalms 24, verse 1. Oh, wait. Sorry. We there? All right. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and those who dwell in it. All right. So God owns everything. He owns you. He owns everything. My point's clear, right? Okay. Now, if God is the owner, then what role do we play? What rights do we have? What responsibility does that create for us? Right? If he's the owner, then what does that make us? His managers, his servants, right? With every manager, with every servant, there becomes a role and a responsibility we're all called to live and walk in, especially when it comes to tithes and offerings, especially when it comes to finances. Now, I mean, this is just a side note. Even look at the parable of the talents. It says, A man went away on a journey and he delegated responsibility, what, to his servants. Well, who are our servants? You and I. All right? So we all have a responsibility to put this before the Lord, okay? To know what we need to do. So we're going to answer that. So I want you to go to Luke 10. All right? Luke 10. Thank you. Okay, Luke 10:27. Okay? Everybody knows this verse. Oh, did I get it wrong? Oh, I'm in 11. Okay, Luke 10:27 says this. And I'm going to just kind of... Luke 10:27. This is Jesus talking to a lawyer, Pharisee. He said this, and he answered, "You shall love the Lord God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your strength, and with all of your mind." Okay? Now, remember the question we asked. What's our role? What's our responsibility? Here's Jesus. This command comes out of Deuteronomy 5, okay? Jesus says, love God with all of our heart. What is that? All of our spirit, okay? That word heart is referring to your spirit, man. Love God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, okay? Your mind, your emotions, your will, all of your mind, that's referring to your thoughts. And then what does he say? All of your strength. Well, that word strength literally means power, influence, and resources. What is God saying here? What is your responsibility? I want you to love me with all of your thoughts, all of your emotions, all of your body, all of your spirit, your home, your cars, your money, your resources. Everything that I have strengthened you with, now I want you to take it and love me back. Mm-hmm. The first commandment. Your money is directly tied to worship to the Lord. You cannot separate worship and money on this earth. It's going to happen. If you look at the Bible, that's an overstatement. But many of the greatest accounts that people did for Jesus is they took their most precious things, they broke it over the Lord and poured onto him, and there was a major expense behind it. And what would it do? It filled the room with the fragrance, and it would bless the Lord. Your money is a tool of worship. He wants you to love him with all of your strength. And I guarantee you, there are some people here in this room. You have a lot of strength. You have a lot of resources. And they're not there for your benefit and for your comfort. It's first to honor King. Now, do you get benefit? Absolutely. He's a loving father who wants to make sure we're all taken care of. Do you get comfort? Absolutely. He's a loving father and he wants you to be comforted. But we have to understand, we're not the owners of these things, we're the managers of it. And God gave it to us so that we can minister to him. Is this making sense? It's powerful. It's powerful. Our role and our responsibility is to love God with all of our strength. And to love God with all of our strength, that means we put our lives on his terms and take our finances and put it at his feet. And what will happen as we break open some of these things that we've been holding on to and are most precious to us, it will minister to him and then begin to minister to others and turn people's hearts to the King of Kings. Because they'll look at it and be like, some people will be like, oh, that's a waste of money. And then they'll be convicted like, whoa, wait a minute, maybe she has her priorities right. Making sense? So our responsibility is to love God with all of our strength. Okay? Now, you'd be led by the Holy Spirit. But, so, with that said, we're going to do a fun exercise here. Okay? I'm going to grab something. Here's what happens in our cultural world today. Alright? We're going to draw out a little pie chart. Alright? Okay? And we're going to make two categories. We're going to make is the budget, all right? In a budget, you have fixed costs and then you have variable costs, right? Mm-hmm. So here's going to be fixed. And then here's going to be variable. What does the word variable mean? Just so
it varies.
yeah, it's different.
It changes.
I love it. It changes, right? Mm-hmm. It changes. It also is maybe negotiable. Let's put that in that category. It's like, it's essential, but it's not essential. So let's go ahead and list some fixed costs that you have in it when it comes to money.
Mortgage.
Booyah. Everybody's like, mortgage. It's so funny when you do this, when I do this, this teaching with, different house churches, and like, you'll have groups of like, millennials. when they're like, you know, rent, and then a group of adults, mortgage, and then, you know, and then when you actually like explain like how much it takes to make it in the world today, they're like, ah, you know, like, okay, so mortgage, everybody said the big thing, mortgage, right? Now, it's a fixed rate, like, you have to have shelter, you gotta live. And you know what? The Lord doesn't want you to live in poverty. I honestly do believe He wants to lavish His children with good things. Okay, so mortgage. This is super important. You gotta have this. So mortgage. What's another fix?
Yes.
Okay. Let's say this. Transportation.
Is mortgage like housing? Is that what's under mortgage?
Yeah, house.
That's like
shelter.
Shelter.
Yeah.
Utility bills.
Utility bills.
Okay, that's another one. We'll go utilities.
That doesn't include cable, though.
Sorry. It doesn't. That's definitely variable.
What about internet?
It is variable, but it's also a non-negotiable. Yeah. You got to
pay.
It's
different than cable.
By fixed, Josh, you want to define fixed? Maybe?
Fixed is like, man, we can't live without this.
Food.
Variable, I guess, so I'm maybe mixing up the terms. Fixed, can't live without it. Variable's like, yeah, we can do without it, but...
Oh, it's not where it's the same thing every month.
Yeah. No. Does that make sense? Thank you.
So discretionary instead of fixed, you have committed commitments and discretion.
You need this to survive, and you've got to do it every month.
Food.
Okay, wait, transportation. But transportation is one of these. Like, in America...
Bike?
You can't go anywhere without getting something. And even if you have a bike, you're going to have some, there's going to be costs. Yeah, you need some form of transportation. Yeah. If you have a family, you're not going to be driving around on your bike. Like, my wife is not packing up the kids in the middle of winter with a cart on the back of her. I'd be like the pastor that makes his wife ride in the snowstorms with his kids. Like, whoa. All right. So transportation, who said it? Food?
Food.
Okay, so food, mortgage is a big cost. Food is a big cost, right? Bigger the family, the more the food is going to require. You know, like, gosh, people will spend $600-$800 a month on food if you have a big family. Lots of kids, like, it's expensive. If you want to eat more and you want to eat healthy, you're going to have a lot of expenses when it comes to food. And we all know as we get older, the more healthy you realize, like, wow, I need to eat healthy. What you put in your body.
It is. You are what you eat.
You are what you eat, right? Okay, so food is a non-negotiable. What else? What's another thing? So we got mortgage, transportation, food.
Clothing.
Okay. All right, clothing does wear out. Clothing, shoes, coat, hat. You know, you need clothing, right? Okay? What's another fix?
Taxes.
Taxes.
Yeah.
That's not a big enough section.
Exactly.
And the shooting
that little pie.
Yeah, so it's taxes. Yeah, you gotta pay taxes, right?
Insurance.
Insurance.
Nowadays,
you have to have insurance.
Yeah.
This is a huge one. Health insurance. Like, and health insurance is crazy expensive, right? Whether you're on Obamacare or not, it doesn't matter. Like, even in, you know, Amy and I do a Christian Samaritans. You know, and it's awesome. We put it to the test. It works, but it's still expensive. So, insurance. Okay, so all these are like fixed things. These are non-negotiable things we have to survive as people, right? Okay. Okay. Any other major ones we're missing? Hold on. Don't really. All right. Next. Okay. So now let's talk about variable. In other words, they're not mandatory for you to survive. They're not mandatory for you to live. But what are some of these things?
Recreation.
All right.
I was just gonna say toys. Same thing.
Cell phone.
Recreation. Okay. It's not mandatory, but it is important and good, but it's not I have to do this. Okay. Now, I am the king of recreation. I love to play. All right. So I get this one. Like, love adventure. But recreation is a big one. Okay. What's another?
Communication, phones, internet.
Phones, internet.
TV.
Okay.
I'm not sure if these are necessarily very
good. Let's go TV. All right, let's just say TV, entertainment. All right, TV, entertainment. All right, how about this one? Expensive exercise memberships.
Yeah. CrossFit.
Vacation. Yeah, CrossFit. Okay, vacation. All right, yeah.
Christmas presents.
Okay, Christmas presents. We're in the Christmas season.
Or little kids.
All presents.
Okay, what else? What else? It's just something that, like, man, the wallet just keeps, like, emptying.
Brand name everything.
What?
Brand name anything.
Brand name anything, right. Yeah, it's, let's just say shopping. Like,
eating out. Anything.
Yeah, right? Eating out.
Eating out, thank you. Eating out.
Very good.
All right. So
now chocolate is fixed.
That's a fix.
Chocolate's fixed. It's like Starbucks.
Yeah.
All right.
Sorry, just a little bit.
No, this is great.
Running out of pot.
So clearly, we could have a lot of fun in like discussing this and like, man, what empties our wallets, right? Yeah. Now here's the deal. We made a whole list. Now Lori, she mentioned something that's really good. But here's what happens in the body of Christ. When it comes to tithe and when it comes to offering, most people approach tithe, offering, and their finances as a variable cost in their monthly budget. So here's what they do. They're like, okay, let's make sure the mortgage is paid. Transportation, gotta eat. Now, and these are legit. I'm not minimizing these things, all right? But most of it is like, man, our lifestyle, we want to make sure we get our lifestyle, okay? And so we're going to feed whatever we can. And then, so they make sure all these things are done. And then they start to be like, okay, so we've got to pay the TV bill. Man, if I don't get CrossFit, I'm going to die.
Chocolate.
Chocolate. You know. Christmas presents, man, you know, like
my pedicure,
my hair. Now again, we don't want a religious spirit in saying these things are bad, okay? We don't want that. That's not what we're going after. But here's what happens. When it comes to tithes and offerings, most people treat tithe and offering as a variable thing, and they fall in the trap of just tipping God or giving when it's convenient. Is this making sense? When reality is, if you're really going to sow into the kingdom and follow Jesus, you have to start treating tithe and offerings as something that is equally as important as your mortgage. Is this making sense? This is a paradigm shift, and the shift is this. Most people, when it comes to tithe and offering and this trap of tipping God and we give God what is left over, it's because they don't walk with this mindset, God owns everything and I'm His special possession manager put on this earth to steward it. Therefore, I own it. Here's the attitude. I own it and I'll give a little bit to God. Rather, He owns it and I steward it well for Him. Is this making sense? Mm-hmm. You guys seen this paradigm shift? Mm-hmm. This is huge. I guarantee. I'm not going. So, now, here's the problem. Here's what happens when people fall in the trap of, wow, when it comes to my money and giving of tithes and offerings, and it falls in this category of variable or like negotiable. All right? They treat this like an option. Well, what happens when you treat your money like an option? You start treating God like an option. Because the next key principle is this. My heart goes where I put my money.
That's huge.
See, what a man sows, is what a man reaps, right? You put blood, work, and sweat into something, you'll own it, right? When you start sowing, if you start sowing into God casually and start treating God as an option, what are you going to reap? God will still love you. He'll take care of you. He'll be an amazing father to you, but you're not going to start storing up treasures in heaven. You're not going to start reaping the dreams that you have as a son and daughter of light. You're not going to see the kingdom fully come forth. And we have to make this transition from here to here because our hearts will follow that. So, let's keep going here. Well, actually, let me say a couple things about this. Alright, this trap where God's optional. Look at Cain and Abel, the story of Cain and Abel in Genesis 4, right? Okay. Both of them had to come, they gave a sacrifice to the Lord, right? Abel's sacrifice was more pleasing to God. What happened? Okay, Cain kind of, here's what Cain did. He's like, okay, I've got this, this, and this. All right. I really want to keep this. What did he fall in the trap? He's like, you know what? I got all this, and then I'm going to make sure this, this, and this is taken care of. And he's like, now I'm going to just give God the leftovers. All right? He gave him the lesser fruit. Here's Abel. So Cain was in this category, right? Here's Abel. What did Abel's like, all right. Sweet. I'm giving him the best. I'm giving him the first fruits. Boom. Gave it to God. What did God say? I love this. This is beautiful. All right. What ended up happening? Cain killed Abel. It revealed what was deeper in the heart, right? Your heart goes, where you put your money. But you see this, you see what I'm saying there? It's a huge, it's a story of this. Am I making sense? Okay, let's look at the rich young ruler in Mark 10. Here's Jesus. He sees a young man with potential and he says, I love him. And he's like, oh, this rich young ruler's like, I want to come follow you. And what did Jesus say? Awesome, come. But there's one thing I want you to do. I want you to sell everything you have and give it to the poor and then come follow me. What did this man have to put on the line to follow Jesus?
His worldly possessions.
His money. Okay? And what was the one thing this man couldn't do? Give up his money. Why? Because the man was so consumed with what he would lose rather than with what he would gain. We're going to go to that. But here's my point. I think this man, he had a pretty awesome cycle here, but he was stuck. He wanted to follow Jesus, but he did not want to. That one thing, he didn't want to make. Well, you guys get the point. You get the point. Because of time, we're going to keep going here. We're running out of time. Okay, so your heart goes where your money is. All right. Matthew 6:21. Let's read this. Do not lay up for yourselves treasure on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. See, when you start sowing in your money, your heart will follow. Okay? this is what the rich are in you. This is what Jesus required of the rich young ruler. He's like, you got to sow in your money, and your heart will become after me and not after your money. Okay? Jesus, he was always, always challenging people and where their treasure really is. Just look at what he says Luke 14. He says this, if anyone wants to follow me, he must hate his father, his mother, his wife, and his children. Right? That's kind of powerful terminology, right? Like, you have to hate your kids, hate your father, hate your mother. That doesn't sound very biblical, right? Right? God is love. How does this add up? What was he saying here? Compared to, this is what Jesus was saying. I want you, your love for me better look as if it's hatred compared for your love for them. There should be no comparison. In other words, I want to be your treasure. What was he confronting at that time in that culture? Your family was everything to you. If you didn't have family, you weren't going to have money. What is Jesus saying? I want to be your treasure. Your love for me better be more important and bigger than anything else. So he's always asking us to lay down our treasures. All right? I say that to say this. The antidote to materialism, the antidote to laying down your treasure, okay, to laying down, getting rid of the culture and the spirit of this age, is through giving. Did that make sense?
Yeah.
You start moving in the opposite spirit.
Right.
Why? Because your heart goes where you put your money. Where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. This is actually a scripture coaching on how to deal with finances. I'll never forget this. There was one time, I was 19, you know, and I had this, it was a God-breathed vision to doing wilderness ministry. And the Lord was like, I got the job at Strom, and back then, Strong was really this ho-dunk little thing in a garage, and I was super excited to instruct, and I definitely didn't have money at the time, and I remember I was into really buying good gear, because you needed it, right? You need it. It was legit, but it kind of started taking a place in my heart. It was like I started drawing some identity from it, not a ton, but maybe a little bit. It's illegal energy. Where it was more exciting to have these things than it was to be in the Lord's presence. So therefore, it was illegal. And so I started just like, I got this sleeping bag that I was just like, this is going to be awesome. I'm going to be so warm. And I'll never forget it. I got it, and I was like, man, sweet. I'm going to be warm at night. And I was just super jazzed about it. Geeking out. We call them gearheads. And it owned me, pretty much. But then I remember sitting there, and the Lord just spoke to me. And he was like, I want you to give this to your missionary friend Caleb in China. And I was like, dang it. I've never experienced that. Dang it. You know? But he was like, I want you to give this. Will you trust me? I want that place in your heart. And I'll never forget, I was like. So then I tested it. I sat on it for a little while. I'm like, okay, Lord, you know, like, let's go first time obedience, but I just want to make sure this is you, because I could really use a sleeping bag.
Just to remind you.
So I sat on it. Okay, God, I could really use this, you know. But then I found out Caleb was actually arriving in America in 2 weeks. And I was like, oh, wow. And come to find out, he's working in an area called the Yunnan province. And it's never been reached for the gospel. And he's doing a lot of missions down there. And I had no money. No money. And so so I showed up church one day, and he was a buddy of mine. I grabbed my sleeping bag, and I was just like, all right, here, bro. This is for you. I gave it to him. To give you an idea how bad this bag today, it would be about $1,000. It was super, super nice. And it was amazing. And he used it for 5 years for remote missions in China. But ever since that day, and I can say this honestly, never before, there really hasn't been an issue with that materialistic gear thing having a hold on me. The moment I gave it away was the moment I became over it and not under it. The moment I gave it away, my heart went to the Lord and not that thing. Okay? You guys seeing the point here? Mm-hmm. And I've really tried to walk a delicate balance in this. And my wife always will give me funny looks because the Lord will still have me, like, he always makes me give away coats. I don't know why. And she'll get mad at me. She's like, do not give away your coat. But like the Lord will speak to me because he'll keep my heart in check. He's like, I want you to keep watching this because, you know, when you do work as in wilderness ministry, you need a good coat, right? If you keep giving away, you got to buy a new one and all these things. But my point is the Lord wants my heart and he wants me to live in this place where he's my treasure and not a thing. And he will always, if there's materialism in your life, he'll probably ask you to give it away because you're contending for that place in him. And he's trying to get you out of this into this. He's trying to get you into this. He's trying to, for you to really realize you're his special possession. So, is this making sense? Is this good?
Yeah.
So point number one, God owns everything. We're his manager put on this earth. Point number two, your heart goes where you put your money. All right? Point number three, and I'm going to hurry because I know we want to be done on time. Heaven, not earth, is your home. Okay. Here's what happens in our culture and our time. Especially when you get sucked into the spirit of the age that says, hey, why make sure all this is taken care of, do all this, and then if there's a little left over, do a good thing and tip God. Alright? People get caught in this trap. Where they're living for the now rather than for eternity. All right? Heaven, not earth, is your home. Okay. See, here's the thing. When we begin to sink our money into temporal things, and compared to all of eternity, it's just going to stay here. But when we begin to sow into the kingdom, what happens? This becomes a launching pad for sending it ahead. Jesus was very clear in his teachings to the body of Christ. You can't take it with you, but you can send it ahead. Right? You can't take it with you. But you can send it ahead. So let's open our Bibles to Luke chapter 12. Luke chapter 12, verse 16. Verse 16, and he told them a parable, saying, The land of a rich man produced plentifully. All right. That's every single person here. We live in America. All right. Do you know 1 out of 7 people live in a slum in the world? That's a crazy thought. 1 out of 7 people live in a slum. So how many people are in this?
What?
Anyways, my point is we're very, 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 very wealthy. All right? So, verse 17. And he thought to himself, what shall I do, for I have nowhere to store my crops? Verse 18. And he said, I will do this. I will tear down my barns and build larger ones. And there I will store up all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample good laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, and be merry. I don't know about you, but I know when I read this and I really sit down before the Lord and pray about it, my whole life, as far as like the educational system I grew up in, the culture I grew up in, pointed to this one thing. Make a lot of money, make sure you make a lot of money, and when you make a lot, keep storing it, because then you can relax, then you can be comfortable, then you can do whatever the heck you want, all right? All right, this is the spirit of the age. This is what we're teaching. The education system teaches our young people. The amount of young people I talk to at the university and through Strong, it's crazy. There is so much pressure on them to live this out. And it doesn't jive with them. Like, they're like, I don't want to do this, but I feel like I have to do this. Store it up, store it up, store it up. That's what it's saying here. But then verse 20. But God said to him, fool. All right. How many know you have a problem if God calls you a fool? Oh, shoot. Right? Ouch. Like, ouch. Like, fool. Like, I mean, I don't know about you, but I do not want to stand before my loving Father in heaven who gave me no excuse and looks at me and says, son, you did all these awesome things, but guess what? You're still a fool. But God said to him, fool, this night your soul is required of you, and the things you have prepared. The things you have prepared, whose will they be? So it is the one who lays up for treasure for himself and is not rich towards God. All right. Now, that scripture is not only just talking about money. It's talking about your whole life. Alright? But we're talking in reference to money. Here's my point. You can't take it with you, but you can send it ahead. You have to have an eternal perspective. And you have to have a plan to... Well, you don't have to, but here's where I'm going with this. It's time the body of Christ starts personalizing their lives with a plan of sending it ahead. Mm-hmm. How many, do you plan your finances? Mm-hmm. Raise your hand. Yeah, sort of, right? Okay, do you have a plan for sending it ahead? Okay, let me just give you an idea here. All right, if I started putting $1 a day aside for my daughter Annika, And I invested it well. By the time she's 18, if we invested it well, she could have over $1 million in an account. Why would she have that $1 million in an account over 18 years? In 18 years, why? Because somebody caught onto something very awesome and put a plan to it and started sending it ahead. Does this make sense?
Yeah.
My point is, most Christians do not have a plan for sending it ahead. And you have a gift of time. In regards to tithe, in regards to offering, that's one of God's gifts to you to start sending it ahead. Is this making sense? You need to start having a plan. So here's what my wife and I do. Every month, first off, tithe is like our mortgage. We're like, let's do this. Awesome. You know, we pay our bills and we write, and our tithe check is in here. All right, tithe. Your tithe goes to the body of believers, the church family you're building with, okay? Really encourage people. You give your tithe to the family you're building with, okay? And we could go into things, but we're not. So my wife and I, we write this right here, boom. But then what we do, our offerings kind of bridge both. So, this is what's so much fun. We have a goal where we want to give away 20% of our income. That's our goal. Why? Because we understand these. God owns it. He put us as managers. Where our money goes, so will our hearts go. And we want to start sowing into heaven, not earth. Okay, we want to send it ahead. We want the kingdom to come here, now, and we want to see the benefits when we die for all of eternity. Do you see what I'm saying here? So, we pay our tithe, but then we take offering, and we ask God. Our goal is to get to 20%. We said, you know, we make sure all the things are taken care of. We're like, okay, what do we want to do? You know, maybe we have $100, maybe we have $50, maybe we have $500. It doesn't, I don't know, whatever that month works out. And then we actually go on a treasure hunt as a family. We pray about it. We seek the Lord on it. Right? Lord, what do you want to do? There are times when He's like, I want you to sow into Rock International. There are times when the Lord's just like, okay, I want you to start sowing into orphans and widows because one day you will be taking care of orphans and widows. Okay? There are times when we know of a need in the body of Christ, and so we'll go and meet that need. There are times, who knows what it is? But as we have put this plan, we know we're sending it ahead, and our hearts are becoming more and more alive and sold out to Jesus. And we're seeing more and more miracles, signs and wonders happen. I don't know how to describe it. It's activating things in the spirit. But we wouldn't be doing this if there wasn't a plan in place, and if we weren't in unity as a husband and wife around the plan. Husbands, if you want to lead your wives, start doing this as a family. Kids will remember how God moved and showed up when it comes to finances. Now, Annika's two. That's our oldest child. But we're already starting it. Trying to teach how to give. So am I making sense? The point is, please, have a plan. Have a plan for sending it ahead. Have a plan for bringing the kingdom. This is what Tim is talking about. And hey, we're having an orientation. We're coming together. We're having a plan. You know what he's doing? He's setting you up for success. That's going to not be the dot of our temporary lives, but for all of eternity. The Lord really spoke to this to me. Actually, my grandfather, it was funny. He's actually in a nursing home. He has Alzheimer's. And so he's not doing well. He's kind of gone. But I remember him processing, he was in a low moment. And he's in a very low moment. He's kind of mad about some finances. And he actually was like, it took me a while to make sense. He blurted, he's like, I'm so mad that I wasted this money. And I was like, what do you mean, Grandpa? And he's like, you know, I gave, I think, like $70,000 to these missionaries. Over the course of, like, they supported missionaries for like 30 years. And over that time, it ended up being about $70,000. Like, I could use that money elsewhere. You know, he had Alzheimer's. He wasn't fully thinking. But when I heard him say that, it was almost like the Lord spoke to me. He's like, well, the Lord did spoke to me. He's like, don't worry. He won't say that when he's with me.
That's right.
But it really spoke to me. I was like, wow, 30 years, $70,000 total. He was supporting missionaries. What he was doing, he was sowing into the kingdom. Mm-hmm. What does he have now? He has a grandson that's on fire for Jesus. Mm-hmm. Holy cow. He has now great grandkids that are going to grow up in a godly home. Holy cow. He has no clue what he sent ahead. Mm-hmm. Making sense? Mm-hmm. Is this good?
Yeah.
Speaking of hearts?
Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Because this has been a thing for me. The scripture in 1 Timothy 5, verse 8, if anyone does not provide for his relatives and especially for his immediate family, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. And this is just his advice about widows, elders, stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah.
And at one point, I mean, this spoke to me so much because my younger sister is a single mom and struggling and so forth. And and I set aside a certain part of my tithe and was giving it to her. And as a result of that, my love for her and her love for God has been renewed. And I guess, I mean, that to me, that's a big deal. But at the same time, I want to be honoring. I mean, this whole thing about 10% to your church and so forth, and without, again, being dishonoring to my church, how does that play in?
Yeah, I'm going to pass this one on. Because this is a good question. This is a good question. Yeah. You know, you never remove freedom from the atmosphere.
Right.
Everybody has to be led by the Lord. This is a great, great, great question.
Yeah. My sense is on that this is a huge one because the tithe, that 10% we're talking about, which is in Malachi 3 and all that, and Leviticus, I feel like that tithe needs to come under the governance of the leadership, the eldership, because the kingdom is about governing. And then bring that issue to them and the deacons and let them fight in prayer with you over that deal. Because what happens is a lot of times is people take personal responsibility to direct their tithes, and they pull it out from underneath the governance of the kingdom. And so they're self-directing in their tithe. And so Josh was more talking about discretionary offerings. Mm-hmm. So that would be in an offering category, what you're doing. Mm-hmm. And I would say, if that burden is on your heart, then let's bring that before the Lord. What he was addressing in that verse was irresponsibility in the body of Christ that thinks I need a free ride. It was entitlement.
Right.
And it's socialism at its worst form, and it actually demotivates people and disempowers people from being ruling and reigning. So what the Bible's saying is you're on the planet to govern and be responsible and not be... So he had a whole other view of compassion. So what can happen is if we bring compassion outside of government, we can slip into unsanctified mercy. Does that make sense? And with entitled people just give stuff away. So I think those kind of things we should bring into the family and process.
So that's a great question.
We gotta watch time here, bro.
What time is
it? No. Answer the question.
I was gonna just share a story. We had a situation in the church that happened where there was something very, very hardcore in that, and the whole body. It was actually the house church tried taking care of it. It became so substantial the house church couldn't take care of it. And then the whole body, we had to put it before the whole body of Christ. And what it was is a husband ran out on a wife, spent all the money on drugs, and racked up all this debt. It was just a terrible situation. Put him in rehab, all these things. And literally, as the church stepped in and met that and just loved this person and started pouring in finances and all these things, the government of God came down, and holy cow, it was better than we could have ever asked or imagined. So that just supports what Tim is saying. Like this, they're reconciled.
Thousands
now.
Of dollars came in to produce that reconciliation.
So,
yeah, it was a dramatic recovery. The body, but it came because it came under governance and not just individual compassion. What happens is when you get a bunch of wise people around something like this, they'll begin to discuss budgeting with that person and responsibility with that person, and then entitlement versus need, that's just versus a handout versus responsibility. So government will bring divine order onto that life, and that's what happened in this case. So I would say just trust the Lord and trust government in that journey, and let them wrestle with it with you. That's a huge one.
I know we got to go. One more quick question.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts on tithing on gross versus net income?
Can I share with you what we do? But then, two things. My personal, what Amy and I landed on, this is what we do. Because we want to maximize our hearts. And this is intense. We actually started tithing off of our gross. And then if we got a tax return, we didn't tithe off of that. But we wanted to honor God with our first fruit, because we wanted God to be our number one thing. Now, that doesn't mean you have to do it that way. So what if people don't want to do it that way, then you go the other way, in the sense you tithe after taxes, and then if you get a tax return, you tithe on your tax return.
Right.
But my what I've noticed, it's costed us more, and our hearts, there a couple times we've been like, ooh. But man, our hearts turned more towards the Lord in that. Does that make sense? So I don't know if that's helpful.
It's a hard question. It is a hard question. And now I believe that if a lot of people have businesses, we have a business. And so if we can't try it on the gross, because we have expenses built on that business, so we have to pay our expenses, and then the gross is after expenses. So it's a little different on that business side of our income. There's not much income, but that side of our income. And so, but you know what? Pray hard. This gap, this 10%, you know, this is, you know, and you want to go to these big verses. I think the tithe in the New Testament is the ground and not the ceiling. It's the floor and not the ceiling. So, again, but not legalism. I've actually helped people start. One time I went to a guy and he was like terrified by this. He had kids. He was a cook. He was a cook in a little restaurant with kids, and he was making like minimum wage plus a little more. He goes, I can't tithe. Literally, my kids will starve. And I mean, that's what he said to me. He says, I literally was weeping. He goes, I want to follow God, but if I let go of this, I'll starve, because I don't make enough to hardly pay the bills now. And I felt that fear inside of him, because he had a poverty spirit on him. And he had a, because he didn't know his daddy was a provider. He didn't have a providing daddy. So it was like literally terrifying to him. Now, I don't necessarily recommend this is going to be on tape, but here we go. I said to him, look, I will stand with you right now in this place of unbelief with you. I know how painful this is. Like, this is terrifying you, right? He goes, I'm terrified. I said, okay. I said, I will stand with you as a guarantor. And I will keep a record, because we have to give you a letter of you know, tax-exempt letter at the end of the year. I said, if literally any time you start starving, you come to me, or if any time you want to retract this and get it back, you come to me. Now, I'm not going to say, you know, say we can do that with everybody, but with this guy, I said, I'll stand with you, whether it was coming out of my own income with it, or I actually stored up some of the church to back it up. But I said, we'll stand with you, because he just didn't have enough faith to make it over the top. You know, between that, his margins were so little. On this guy, he just wrote the check. And, I mean, it was terrifying to him. Within literally a couple of weeks, he had been promoted, he'd been raised, then he got another job, then he started working for another company. Now this guy is making massive money. And it's all because he started this supernatural, I never had to recover his money, I never had to, like, give it back to him. But I understand what gut grind this is for a lot of people. And, but the reason why we're going to press this, not every week or anything like that, but just leave it, get in front of you, is we want to show you how much of the daddy you have. And the supernatural comes when you let the Lord lift you into this place. And our whole lives are a miracle. On this. There's no explanation for our lives apart from this. So, are you got a concluding profound moment of statement? A concluding bam? I mean, that was amazing. Was that awesome?
Yeah.
Final, because I just jumped up here.
No, I actually don't. That was it. No, that was like, you know, the technical questions are really good. And these are great.
Yeah, we're going to go in a life dialogue on this. And
I will say this. Technical questions are good, and they need to be asked and answered. But what I felt the Lord really wanted to get is the heart and the principle. Because if you get this, the technical questions won't mean much. They'll just be automatically answered. You know what I'm saying? Because that's how good He is. That's how faithful He is. That's how amazing He is. And so...
Cool.
It's a journey of discovery is what it is.
Isn't that the one where God said to actually test Him in this?
Yeah, Malachi 3:6. He goes, man, He says, you've left me. Draw near to me. And they said, how can we draw near to you? He goes, draw near to me through your tithe, since you've been stealing from me. And I will come to you, but this thing is idolatry. This is standing between me and you. So to test me in this tithing. And yeah, Malachi, it's a phenomenal verse. It's a phenomenal verse. I love, economically, I love what we call the 10-10-80 plan. You straight off the top, tithe 10. Then save 10% and then live on 80. And if you start saving 10%, and there's a place for saving. Mm-hmm. Oh. It's what's happening is, what Josh's talking about is that, you know, is all for me. But 10-10-80 is a great way to live. So if you save 10% or invest it in properties that generate income. So I began encouraging Josh. I started praying for Josh to begin getting investments that will be residual in income. And basically, you want to start having money work for you. So we prayed, and now Josh owns an apartment building.
A five-unit
apartment building, and somebody else is actually paying off that building. He's got a little profit margin. But again, that was an answer to prayer due to his faithfulness in economics. There's other ways that God will come in, and we have hundreds of stories of how God stepped in and began the process of developing wealth in people, generational wealth to leave for your kids and kids' kids. So we're not down on saving and generating income and accumulating and developing wealth. We're just saying it's the heart, it's the way we dance with the Lord around economics so that we don't get under stuff, we get under the Lord. And then we watch God come in and provide. So, hey man, we're going to be back here next week. Now listen, we got one or two, you can bring this up. Well, let me just pray. Is it on? Let's just pray for a miracle right now and a liberation in the heart area. Father, right here, this couldn't be more tough for most people, but I pray that those watching, those in this room, those that will join our church in the future, that you would give the anointing of the Holy Spirit to liberate us from the fear of loss and the fear of economics, and cause us to live with freedom and to trust you, God, for our economics. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.